So it's 4:30, so we'll have Hiro deliver the fourth and final lecture in this series.
All right, so let me continue the discussion on the three-dimensional case with a quadratic nonlinearity. So as I discussed, in the heat case, local vortices is easy, just double dimension. That, thanks to the 2-degree smoothing, and sorry, but that's in your paper, right? With Adolf Jensen and also Uriana. Yes, so in the following, I will use I, supposedly math comma I, to denote the Hamilton integral operator for the wave equation. So that's an integration with sine, t d divided by d kind of things, if you remember. And as in the two-dimensional case, we can define the weak power like this, and sigma n is precisely the, well, in this case, still time dependent, the stochastic convolution square, right? And then this time, it grows like n. Previously, okay, it was n here, truncated, sorry. And so n here. So this means projection of the low frequencies of the stochastic convolution. And this converges by the same argument to something, and that's in this regularity. And the proof is exactly the same. You just take a Fourier transform and compute the second moment and see how fast it decays. But also in the following formal discussion, just an informal discussion, all I'm doing is just I'm adding the negative two negative regularities. -1/2, -1/2. And the second order stochastic object. So with a quadratic nonlinearity, and suppose initial data is zero, then Picard iteration, the Picard second iteration gives you this, right, the new piece. So it's this. And if you remember what this is sine t minus t prime lambda divided by lambda, so you gain one derivative. So if you use a naive parabolic thinking, I mean, of course, I don't mean really, no offense, but right, then what you get is that you have -1/2, -1/2, and then one gain the derivative, you expect 0-. So it's not even a function. And that's the end of the story. But actually, there is a nonlinear dispersive smoothing. And showing, we can show that this guy has regularity 1/2-. So there's a gain of regularity 1/2. Okay? And that I will say later. In this hyperbolic setting or dispersive setting, one is this extra nonlinear smoothing, which doesn't exist in the heat case, because heat case the way we think is that okay, you have each term should make a distribution and a regularity, and you count the regularity and then you apply the 2-degree smoothing. But for the dispersive case, if you do it, that's the end of the story, especially for Schrodinger equation, because there is no smoothing. But often you get a nonlinear smoothing, which will allow you to make sense of the Hamilton integral. Okay. And so instead of the Brown Dobush expansion, that's a first order, we expand up to the second order. The remainder B. Satisfies this equation. This comes from this piece. And the point is that now you have this stochastic convolution squared with minus sign. Renormalize, then this kills this piece. That's the whole point of, not the whole point, but one of the points.
A bit too strong.
It's good for me, but yeah. So here, okay, this term doesn't involve in the unknown B, so I can compute the regularity. And then if it makes sense, it should inherit, so this guy has positive regularity, but it should inherit the bad regularity of this stochastic convolution, which is minus 1/2. So you expect B to have 1 plus that regularity. Right, that's minus 1/2 plus 1. Okay? That means you have an issue here. Because the sum of regularity is negative. Tiny bit negative. Okay? And by the way, so except for multiplying and losing, all these formal computation is basically the same as harmonic 5-4-3. And you can find a nice expression in the introduction of the paper by Murat and Weber. And that's where I learned the whole business first. Right. And so this is not enough. Now I need to introduce the power control ambience. But before going further, just let me first give a brief review of the power product. So first is the unitary projector or projection. So I'm just switching my notation. It doesn't matter. So I'm using P sub j to denote the projection operator onto frequencies around 2 to j. Remember that I wrote P less than n to denote the frequency less than n. Right? It's a bit abusive notation. Maybe k double different, as long as you are consistent, that's fine. So you just define by the smooth multiplier, so and so. And the power product is that what it says is that if you have a product of two functions, of course when I say functions, I include distributions, you can write into three pieces. And it takes a bit of time to write, but it doesn't say much. So the first piece say that f less than g, that's the power product of g by f, and that says that the frequencies of g is much larger than the frequency of f, that this shows. Right? And then this piece is the resonant product of f and g, that says that frequencies of f and g are pretty close by the magnitude or whatever. So this two is not important, you can choose five if you like. And then also k less than g minus 2. For the same thing. And the last piece is the power product of F by G. And the point is that the power product always makes sense as a distribution. And the regularity, in terms of regularity, is basically given by the high frequency piece. So let me say the linearity of this now is S1, this is S2. Then the linearity of half order is given by S2. But if f is not a function but a distribution, then you need to take it off. So it's the S2 minimum of S1 plus S2. Okay? And then the resonant product is an issue. So resonant product. Makes sense in general. In general, some of the majority is positive.
Okay.
So what do we mean by this in general, and how do we overcome? Is we impose a structure. I think I already mentioned in the first lecture something, right? There are two key ingredients. One is the decomposition of solution map into two steps, and the other part is the impose of structure. We only impose a structure by us imposing the second order expansion, but I did not impose anything about the V. Of course, I can impose some structure on V. And what is the worst guy on the right hand side of the V equation is the stochastic convolution. The rest is good. And you have a product of function or distribution with a stochastic convolution. And when does it have a bad regularity? Is in terms of power product, right? So it has a bad regularity if stochastic convolution has high frequency, meaning if it's given by the power product less than stochastic convolution. Is this clear what I said? I will write it. So we write, so power control outlets, we write V equals X plus Y, and then to save time, can I use box to denote a linear part? It's not a big box, plus one, but. So, just I did what I said. So, I just wrote down all the terms that appears on the right-hand side of the equation. The worst piece is given by this piece, right? The high-frequency piece is given by the stochastic convolution. Because if you have the other way, then these guys have positive regularity. So I postulate this guy has regularity 1/2. And then this guy, we postulate at least as regular system, then this has positive regularity. So if it's the other way, you will add this piece. Right? It gives better regularity. And why call the power control? And that's in the heat case. From here, you introduce commutators, then you can really say that you are imposing power control structure on B. In the red case, you cannot. What you are doing is you are imposing the power control structure on. The box of V. Right? Because box of V is box of X plus box of Y. Box of Y is something, power control, that power product with stochastic convolution. So then of course I should say, we say F, given a general distribution called the power control, by a given reference distribution G, if f can be written as this, for some smoother h, and here f prime doesn't denote derivative, but I'm just using it to remind that this corresponds to the Dubinet derivative in the control path theory, right? Okay, alright. So let me move on. So this piece has a regularity. So this is positive. This has positive regularity, but it doesn't help because it's on the low frequency side. So this guy has regularity minus 1/2. So x has regularity 1/2 minus. Okay. Now for now, let me ignore the resonant product in the y equation. Okay? Just making sense of this resonant product is basically everything. Now let me just ignore it so that we can guess the regularity of y. And a posteriori, by estimate, we prove that it is indeed the case. Okay, so this square has positive regularity because everything is functional. And this piece, if you have this, then we postulate the x and y are as regular as this guy. That means it has regularity 1/2 minus, and this has regularity minus 1/2 minus, so this has regularity 2 minus. That means you expect y to have regularity 1 minus. Because of the differential integral operator. Okay? Is this okay? Maybe here, gaining 1, right? This is because it's weight, it's not the heat. So this says, for example, the resonant product here with y makes sense. Since if the regularity of y is greater than 1/2. So I forgot to say, sorry. I assume x has regularity s1 and y has regularity s2 and this. And s2 is like a 1/2 minus and s1. So s1 is 1/2 minus, s2 is greater than 1/2. The sum of the regularities can be positive. Hence, resonant product makes sense. Right? So I'm going quickly that, of course, this is just an easy part. Right? You look at it, you just add the derivatives. But if you have questions, please do ask. Now, there are two more pieces in the resonant product. And one is the second order stochastic object, resonant product with the stochastic convolution. And that, by our rule, we can make sense of it. I mean, of course, you need to prove it. And you can compute its regularity. So, another resonant product we need to consider is this, right? So, what we need to do is make sense of the right-hand side of the y equation. The x equation, right-hand side is power product. Everything makes sense. No problem. Okay? And this we denote maybe by this, and this makes sense, and the regularity just sum of these two. So that's 0 minus, because that's 1 half minus 1 half, 0 minus. And the point is that no need to do any further minimalization. So although the parabolic and hyperbolic wave equations behave very differently, but there is one thing in common. That is, what minimalization do we need? The reason is because they share the same invariant measure. I mean, okay, this, there is no invariant measure in this case, but formally speaking, that means the nature of the singularity is the same. So, and the, at the first step, we already applied the weak renormalization for the stochastic convolutional square, and that should be all in this case. Okay? And here, this also means a nonlinear smoothing, dispersive smoothing. Right? Meaning, we have this piece, but we cannot just combine the estimate of this with this. We really need to directly estimate this cubic term using nonlinear smoothing. Also, symmetrization argument. So I will, if I have time, I will explain. But what I mean by this is that you need to perform the summation on the Fourier side. So the way we compute the regularity of these objects is to by computing the second moment of the Fourier coefficient as before, using the lemma 2, if you remember, right? Then there are lots of summations with some oscillations because of sine. So that's, and if you put absolute value, this summation is divergent, by the way, logarithmically divergent. So you need to make use of oscillation. And so that means the sum is not absolutely convergent, so you have a conditionally convergent summation. So it is up to you to decide how you sum. And we pair these two and sum, then there is a cancellation. If you sum in positive one direction of N2 and the other direction separately, you're screwed. Okay? And this is a typical kind of cancellation property one needs to exploit in studying dispersive equations, which is not present in the heat case. Because heat case, this is what you have, which is positive. You can put absolute value. Nothing changes. But then in the wave case, this is what you have. And if you put absolute value, you get one. Okay. So,
N2 is a Fourier model of what?
Something. No, but you see.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, just I'm using the same notation as the paper, and also if I get to it. So, some frequency. And, but thank you, of course. So, does this sort of the worst term is this piece? Because as it is, x has regularity 1 half minus, and stochastic convolution has minus 1 half minus. So the sum of the regularity is negative, so the product doesn't make sense. But once again, we use a structure. X is not just any function. X is written like that. So we just write x as a using a Dehandle formulation. So then we use S of t to denote that linear propagate on the vector, meaning time derivative s on the zero, and then, right, if you remember. And minus 2i x plus y minus this piece. What do you call this thing? You know, you measure with wood and with a rubber and you kind of shoot a
slingshot.
Slingshot, right? So slingshot, right? So I was just sorry. So, because I need some name, right? Because for the cubic case, you say chicken foot or chicken leg or something, and then, but yeah, so slingshot, right? And you try to form a resonant product with each piece, with the design, okay? So the resonant product. Sorry, can I fix? I mean, user UI is okay, but let me put just X0, X1. So, This can be given a meaning using stochastic analysis. Okay? I'm not going to show, this is the easy part, but then Z has a regularity. That in CT H S1 minus 1 half minus epsilon. Not even W S infinity. Only L2, because it has this L2 structure here. It can be just arbitrary. Okay? And so this will be a part of the enhanced dataset a priori given. Okay? I'll get to this point, but this is very different from the probability case because now initial data is part of the, so meaning the probability one set you construct to prove almost sure local opposites depends on the choice of initial data, actually. Which is not something we like, but that's like set of probability one for local opposites depends on x0, x1. So here, u0 is x0 plus y0, u1 equals x1 plus y1. So if the initial data is smooth, then there is no x0, x1. Then we can choose a set of probability 1 independent of initial data. But for rough data, it will depend on it. Okay? Now the main part. So let me write down what we would do in the usual power control calculus approach in a parabolic setting to make sense of this resonant product of this guy with the stochastic convolution. So we introduce two commutators. The first is that you try to insert this Duhamel integral operator, commute this with the power product. Okay? And then you try to commute this power product with the resonant product. That has nothing to do with the equation. So this is very true about the, sorry, plus the commutator. So if I commute okay. Once we are at this point, this guy is an explicit stochastic object. That means by our rule we know how to make sense. And this is the power product, so it makes sense. So this guy, everything makes sense here. Except that maybe commutator one, right, need to make sense of this guy, this has to have regularity 1 half plus epsilon. But this guy is 1 half minus epsilon because of this piece, for example. That means they must be smooth on here. And in the power case, you can prove it. But in the dispersive case, it is false. There is no such thing. So, this approach fails. The second commutator is smooth, because that's just a, that has nothing to do with the equation. Okay? So what we do is we try to make sense of it directly. So we introduce what I call power control operators. So so this value is just an input function, and just we define the power control operator. All I mean is the Hamilton integral operator with the power control power product structure embedded, or power control structure embedded. Right? Is okay. So well, let me not write down what this means in terms of the. On the Fourier side, I can write it, but it takes too much time. And here, I use, I checked this morning, MathFrak I, but I don't know how to write MathFrak by hand, so just I use J. So, make sense of this line. Right, directly. And at this point, and I'm not using any structure about W, I will not use any structure anymore. This is just about the operator, random operator. And I just studied mapping property. Almost sure mapping property. Okay? So, first step is divide this power control operator into the good and bad parts. Okay, so of course here, so the W has really 1/2 minus regularity. Right? W for our application is x plus y minus a screenshot. Right, so I'll explain. So W here inside the power control operator, of course there are two frequencies, right? N1 frequency for the W and then N2 frequency for stochastic convolution, and the output is N equals N1 plus N2. That means I'm assuming N1 is much smaller than N2. Meaning in the according to the definition of power product. Okay? Much less means not arbitrarily small, like less than 1 over 20, whatever it is. But now, for the first one, I impose that it's not too small. Okay? Now in this case, we can make use of our assumption that W has positive regularity, and actually this J1 has a smoothing property. Is this okay, the definition? Not about smoothing property. I just separated into two pieces this power control operator. So what do we want for the J1 piece? So smoothing means W has regularity 1 half minus epsilon, but I want the output to have regularity 1 half plus epsilon. Right, that means you multiply by n to the 1 half plus epsilon on the Fourier side and try to estimate. Right? So, just a forehand note, my note, just let me just write with 2 epsilon, never mind. And Duhamel integral has this piece because it's I, right? The definition of the power control operator. And in this case, so n1 is much less than n2. Which means n2 must be of the same size as n. That means I can replace this by n2. Okay? But n2 to the power of theta has an upper bound, or n2 has an upper bound, n1 to the 1 over theta. Here theta is supposed to be a very small number. That means I can bound by this. But here, theta is the given small number, but I can now choose epsilon to be much smaller. So that this will be less than S1. Or S1 minus epsilon, I don't know. Maybe or like I did a little padding or something. This will be multiplied to the stochastic convolution, that's the correct regularity. This will be multiplied to the W, which is the correct regularity. So this shows the smoothing property. And that's really the heart of the proof. Right? This is a trivial part. By choosing epsilon sufficiently small. Sorry. Okay? So this and let me be sloppy, let me not. Full version. The correct statement is that suppose you have a deterministic distribution. So here I'm writing a stochastic convolution, but pretend it's a deterministic guy. I know it's regularity. We can define this J1 replacing this stochastic convolution by this deterministic guy. Then this mapping property holds. So this is a deterministic statement, no probability. Okay. And then now it's smooth. Okay. So Bresnahan product makes sense. Now, that case is this. Then, positive regularity of W doesn't help. So, we directly define another power control operator. Now we use probability stochastic analysis to make sense of this. Okay? And okay, so here I wrote L2 because I followed the notes on the paper. So, And this is L1, and L1 is the CP L2 X. So here, for this part, I need to assume some temporal regularity. I will explain, but anyway. Yeah, that's some observability. Okay? Meaning, so for the J1 piece, I still need to take a resonant product with the stochastic convolution. So regularity must be greater than 1. But this guy I already mentioned directly. Okay? So what you do is you study the kernel of this operator. Kernel contains how many stochastic convolutions? 1, 2, right? And then you just compute, right? So this is a part of the data set, enhanced data set. J1 is not. And the proof, so there are many different parts, and easy part, you just compute directly and use column of compute criterion, and then difficult part, you need to use synergization argument, like that, this slingshot resonant product with a stochastic convolution, and also you need to use integration by parts to gain some oscillatory factor or the method of stationary phase, for which you need some time regularity for W. Here we put C1 because we were lazy. But in the next work that I say chapter 3, that we only use a C alpha regularity. And here, what I found a bit interesting is that this is basically what replaces the commutator 1, or the commutator 2 as well, but in the power control approach in the parabolic setting. And if you are familiar with the argument in Rapp Weaver, they need to come for proving the smoothing property of commutator 1, you need temporal regularity. So it's kind of funny that this one also requires temporal regularity as well. And if you write a difference, you see. So, final form. The box of X is exactly the same. The box of Y has many pieces. So, the square piece, no problem, because every term has positive regularity. And the product piece, no problem, because power product always makes sense. And the resonant product with Y, no problem, because Y has good regularity. And then this stochastic guy, no problem, using stochastic analysis. And this guy is, so there is no red, right? I don't know if you can see purple, but oh, you can see. So this guy is something we need to introduce, but using stochastic analysis, and in making sense of the resonant product with X, first is the linear solution part, and second piece is this good part of the power control operator. So this, you don't need any stochastic analysis, and the bad part of the power control operator, which already encodes resonant product. So this guy, you need stochastic analysis, and this guy, you need stochastic analysis. And initial data is x0, x1, y0, y1, let me not write it.
But is it G2 in the
I mean, this is J2 resonant product with this, but J2 resonant product with stochastic convolution doesn't make sense deterministically. So, theorem, I don't know what number, 19, is Okay. It doesn't matter. Just let me note. Right. This is local force with some initial data regularity for the x less than 1/2, for the y greater than 1/2, and some condition. And enhanced data set, let me just write it, right? Enhanced data set is so enhanced data set means the list of things for which we need to use stochastic analysis to make sense. But in other words, if let me write it. You are given with these guys, forget about them being random, deterministic. So here you see these guys exactly. Except for x and y, everything is just this. Okay, this is deterministic. The well-defined guy. Then there's a continuous dependence from this enhanced data set to a solution x and y. With some topology. So we don't need any stochastic analysis to make sense about this well-posed spot. And how we do it is that there was a question about string analysis, I wrote a note, but then I don't think I have time. Sorry, so you can read it in the scan notes. As you can see, I'm flipping. It's probably more useful to talk about key points about this mountainous smoothing. And by the way, also string hat estimate. Actually, we do need to use string hat estimate, but in a rather trivial manner, in the sense that the here nonlinearity is quadratic. And in order to handle the first term on the right hand side of y equation, that's the x plus y plus slingshot square, that's the only place where we use string hat estimate, because the rest is linear in x and y. Right, so that for other terms, just the only thing you need is 1 degree of smoothing from the Hamiltonian integral operator. Right? But in the 2D case, right, when you handle the higher order nonlinearity, then you have b to the power j times stochastic convolution of the weak power to power k minus j, and you need to handle b to the j for j from 1 to k. Then you need to use string hat estimate in the careful manner. So here, right, although I wrote the string hat estimate, but the application is rather straightforward. Okay. And also, if you want to learn at least the indices, what relevant indices, in the stochastic 2D stochastic wave paper, it's written in a very compact manner, so it's a bit hard to see. Now you can also take a look on the paper, my paper with Laurent Thomas on the 2D NLW with random data. There's space, I use so-called excess space. It may be scary, but you can see what admissible pairs I use. Okay, so let me just mention the key point of the construction of the slingshot. So as before, we compute the Fourier transform and the computed second moment, and our goal is to bound it. So you are up to some constant.
Say N1 is not plus minus N2.
And you have the product of weak power and compute expectation Q. Okay? And which I denote at two different times too. And here, sigma sub n means and I think there should be no. In my note, I'm missing, and I try to fix what I left for you. Just like, look up, for a precise expression, look up. Okay? But the following
the one and two there, and the integrals?
Hmm? Sorry?
The n and the integrals is n1 and n2.
N1, sorry.
Upstairs.
No, those are the two connecting to roots.
The output.
Okay.
So,
yeah.
Right, this, right. So this is frequency N1, N1 paired, N2, N2 paired, output is N. Then I should write it this way. Anyway, so you just expand sine and cosine in terms of, so these guys are good guys because it has fast decay, faster decay. This is a difficult term. And I expand, so the point is that, right, I have a n here, and I need to sum up in one variables. Degree is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 6, and if I sum in three dimensions, I use 3. That means I only have n to the minus 3. And then I want this to be n to the minus 4 to show the 1 half degree smoothing. If you get just n to the minus 3, that's the parabolic thinking. Okay? And so you expand, then you get something like so this epsilon j's are just a plus minus ones, whichever it is, depending on sine, cosine, whatever you know, expand. T2 squared is and let me only write down the kappa 1, which is epsilon 1 and epsilon 3 and 1, epsilon 4 and 2. And kappa 2 is kind of something similar. And here, epsilon j is just a plus minus sign, right? Because when you expand sine and cosine, you get the plus minus of these exponentials. And when you integrate this one, okay, this one maybe T1. In T1 first, by switching over the integral, you can get this piece from this integral. Okay? But now I put absolutes, I kill this guy. I have this piece plus this. So we want to show and this is less than n to the minus 4 plus epsilon. To consider different cases. Right? So if epsilon 1, so with very loss of generality I can assume epsilon 1 is positive, then if epsilon 3 and 4 are negative, minus 1, then of course it's easy because the kappa 1 is a positive number. But a bad case happens when, of course, they have opposite signs. But this is really the, what I mean by multilinear dispersion, called trying to explore multilinear dispersion, right? Because dispersive part is e to the it Japanese bracket of n, or n1 or n2. But now this kappa 1 is combining these all together, not separately. Because if you try to do it separately, then you put absolute value and everything is 1. So what we're trying to do, this is really the multilinear dispersive part. So worst case is one of the bad case. I'm not of course doing all the cases. Assuming this condition, meaning this is just by symmetry and then this is otherwise trivial or something like this. Okay? Then, in this case, we have this. What's the point? If I want this to be large, because it appears in the denominator. If it's not large, then their angles should be small. They should be cross the collinear, right? So first, N1 is like a max of N2, just under this assumption, never mind. But, so let me draw, yes, this is N, which is N1 plus N2. And this is N2, and this is N1, because they sum up to be zero, so it's they form a triangle, right, on the frequency side. And by, for some reason, just I call this side theta, not this kind of side. Then, law of cosine says here, this angle is the this side. Okay, I'll switch it soon. So this is just a lower cosine, nothing. And I want to put the lower bound on kappa 1. Then I'm happy. So I have plus plus minus. Then let me multiply by plus plus plus. Then I get this square minus this square. Okay? A plus b times a minus b is a square minus b square. So kappa 1 n is N2 square minus N1 square, and then I multiply this guy, both numerator and denominator. Now I expand, and then, you know, if I expand, I get this guy squared. But Japanese bracket square is nothing but absolute value square plus 1. 1, I don't care, okay? Then exactly I can use this law of cosine. Okay? Then let me skip one step, sorry, to save time. Law of cosine. So there will be 2 plus 1s and 1 minus 1, but I just throw it away. This. And where theta is that guy. So theta is the angle of N2. Is minus n. Okay? Now we need to separate the estimate. And case one, right? So this kappa 1 appears in the denominator. So this 2 power appears in the denominator while 1 power is upstairs. But if this guy is not super small, we win, because we get 1 power. Okay, so then this case is easy. mean, I ask you some of the properties, but there is. But the second case is hard. Well, not hard. So in this case, cosine theta is very close to 1. That means theta is very close to 0. That means 1 minus cosine theta should be close to theta squared by Taylor expansion. So this is much smaller than 1. Okay, now in this case, we have this 1 minus cosine theta in the denominator, which is supposed to be small, so that's really bad. We need to somehow kill it, right? Otherwise, we don't get any reasonable summation. So let me draw another picture. So dynamically decomposed N2 means, yes, let's separate summation so that N2 is like a capital N2, which is like 2 to the j, whatever it is. And then let's sum up capital N2 later. So first, let's reshift my attention. The fix n, then the same n, theta is very small, that means n2 should be pointing in a really almost opposite direction. Angle, I don't know, meaning in this circular way. I know it has to be sized around N2. That means it must be contained in a cone, or lower half of the cone. Okay? We are always in, just estimated by the cone. Summation means you compute the volume, right? So cone here, the height is, okay, height is N2 cosine theta, which is N2, because theta is close to 0, and the radius of the base disk is N2 sine theta, which is N2 theta. That means volume of the cone is this height times base radius square. Okay? So now this allows me to sum. So this I erase, but whatever I want to sum is n equals n1 plus n2 for fixed n. That means I am just summing over only n2. But now I fix the dynamic size. Then what's left is n cube and max of n, n2, that's the n1, it's by assumption, n, that's from the kappa, because 1 minus cosine theta is now theta squared, okay, kappa 1, but, so theta being small is a bad thing, but exactly the volume is this, which kills this, and that gives the desired estimate. And of course, I could continue about the symmetrization argument, but maybe not. Okay? And so this part was needed to make sense of Sun Shot and to show X-Shot-1-Han smoothing. And the point is that, right, I mean, the parabolic equation, there is really no monthly estimate. you only apply held up and apply smoothing or something. The reason is because the phase doesn't interact, because you have e to the minus tn squared, e to the minus tn1 squared, they're separate. And each of them are super strong. But wave case or Schrodinger case even worse, you really need to bring this multilinear phase downstairs. But when you bring things downstairs, it could be really bad when they're collinear in this quadratic case. Or you know, the oscillatory phase. So for that Schrodinger case, you need to understand this. And by the way, this is zero exactly when four frequencies are in the rectangle, which is not clear from here, but actually you can write it like this. Okay? That means you need to really understand the geometry. And then you need to separately estimate when phase is close to being zero. So phase here means multilinear phase kappa 1 being close to zero. In this case, what helps is the smallness of the measure of your bad set. That's how you handle what's called a resonant set or nearly resonant set. Here, resonant doesn't have anything to do with the resonant product. This is what we mean by resonant in dispersive PDE, about the multilinear level. And if it's highly oscillatory, non-resonant, you gain a lot. And then you want to balance by what you mean by large, what you mean by small, meaning resonant, non-resonant. Okay? And so let me, sorry, give me a second. So how many minutes do I have? 5 minutes or something?
5.
Yeah, I think. Yeah, you have like maybe 8 minutes.
Wait, I'm not gonna show my estimate because I know I went fast this time, right? But this is how we teach. Anyway, so yeah, so this was just trying to give a flavor, right? How things are a bit different. And what I mean by multilinear smoothing. And many questions are open. And sorry, I didn't get to write down anything about chapter 3, but then if you consider that cubic case, by the cubic wave equation, stochastic case is completely open. But if you smooth out the noise, there is a result. And if you multiply by, or combo, smooth out by smoothing operator of degree 1, as I said, this still has a bad part here. So this product cannot be more smoother than the stochastic convolution. Right? Then, just what I did is that I used basically the same, it happened at that I computed, then same power control operators appear, both of them. And you rewrite the system, only the first expansion, the product abuse, and the power control ansatz, and then three pieces. So you want to write this into the equation for x, and then x tilde, which is supposed to mean this piece that you cannot make sense, and the y. So you get the system of three equations you can solve. And so there are many open questions, of course. And in the case of the 2D case, then after the polynomial, what you study is maybe the non-polynomial, non-power type nonlinearity, which can be the sine Gordon model or exponential type nonlinearity, and there are some results. We can take a look. And in the case of the exponential nonlinearity, one needs to exploit the structure of the equation, which has a sine definite structure. But then in the case of the wave equation, then you further need to reduce the system. And but then the range we have is very far from being critical or anything. And lastly, here in this case, in this series of lecture, I talked about the easier wave equation. The Schrodinger equation is much harder. In the sense that, because much harder, as in it's a different beast in the sense that there is no smoothing. So wave equation, the starting point is kind of similar to heat equation because there is 1 degree of smoothing. So stochastic convolution has the same regularity. So that kind of allows us to mimic some part up to some point, the parabolic theory, but for the Schrodinger, from the first step, it's completely different. And the one-dimensional cubic Schrodinger equation forced by spatial white noise already is. Many people think that it's critical, it's non-trivial. I mean, it's very difficult. And if you smooth out that, or if you take a stronger dispersion, I mean not the second derivative, but a bit higher, then one can prove more poseless. But even that, you need to introduce random operators like we did here. But not power control structure, because power control structure is completely useless in the Schrodinger case. So what I mean is that the power control structure here only cares about small or largeness of the spatial frequencies. And for the wave or for the heat, it's good, it's useful. For Schrodinger, it's completely useless in the sense that the Schrodinger case, what's important is not only the spatial frequency, but also the modulation. This is something called modulation, is important too. Then when you compute a product of two functions or three functions, then you need to be able to estimate something about the modulation. Otherwise, you cannot prove anything. This is really the starting point of the so-called Bourdain's free excessive spaces, free restriction method. Of course, I should mention the name of Kernel-Nappelmann too, in the wave context. Wave context, you don't need it, unless you deal with derivative momentum. So what I'm trying to say is that in studying Schrodinger equation, what is resonant is not only a resonant in the spatial frequency, but also resonant in the twisted temporal frequency as well. If you have resonant product in the spatial frequency, but if you have help from the temporal oscillation, you can still do something. And you need to analyze basically both resonant in the spatial kind of frequency way and this modulation way. So maybe I'll stop here.
Are there any questions for Hiro?
So in the cubic case, do you know in principle what the regularity is of the stochastic objects? I mean, this multilinear thing?
No. I mean, we've been talking, but then many cases, we get some 1 degree smoothing, but some cases we don't, and then we don't know. For example, if you only get one half, then that's the, this guy, chicken leg, is below zero, so it's not good. Right. So even that, we don't know. And also the power control operators, of course, I can write down what we need, right? This part of me, first step is something like this. And we have enough smoothing properties actually. If you try to do folding fingers, then of course it's really bad. Far from what we want. And I don't want many. It's a long way to go.
Any
I have a question about the power controlled operator. So inside you have the power product, which is a low-high product, which means that power product is already behaving like the cherry in high frequencies. Why does this help intuitively? Why does having multiplying it with, I mean, it will still behave like the high, its high frequencies will still behave like the cherry operator. But what? Why does it help when you randomize the
No, no, this is not randomizing. This is so there are two pieces, J1 and J2. So J1 helps because I can exploit the positive regulator of this guy.
Okay.
Because if N1 is not too small, then I can take part of N2 and hide it here. That's a deterministic manner. And in the second case is really writing and the internal sine, cosine, and then you do something like this.
Okay.
Well, also symmetrization argument more like. So symmetrization argument means like something like this. Well, I have some denominator, but then suppose, forget the second term, I only have this. But sum is symmetric around N2, so the origin. Then I have plus N2 and minus N2. And somehow, okay, there is some sum. Then Then I can use mean value theorem, and then actually I can get some numbers.
Okay.
So it helps to sum up N2 and minus N2 together. And that kind of thing takes place. I mean, it's not a randomness, it's an oscillatory nature of things.
Okay, so if there are no other questions, let's thank Hiro for his four lectures.